Well, this needs to be set up a little bit. It needs a little bit of explaining, if that's possible.
Previously on Comedy Bang Bang.
I am a dirtbag.
You're my best friend.
I love you,
for the last 3 years.
I mean, yes, I'm immortal.
Well, you were also a magical being.
That's not important, Scott. I was walking down the street.
Just the other day?
I was walking down the street just the other day.
I got a new job. Well. Scott, I'm the devil now.
The devil himself?
This is the last time I can appear on the podcast.
What? No, you're one of our favorite guests.
With every second I'm outside of hell, my power grows weaker, Scott.
Gosh.
And it was evidence of an enemy who's been hunting me down since, well, the very beginning of time. Now that I'm in hell, well, there's room for this enemy to run free, Scott. This enemy is my daughter.
Hi!
Hi, hello.
My name's Judy.
Oh, hello, Judy.
Judy North. Okay. She may come in the form of another comedic character. You will never know, Scott!
Rudy, don't go!
Owner of a donut shop.
I know the fans are going to be so sad.
I think they will be. I mean, you're one of our favorites.
You know? Yep. Goodbye, Scott.
Goodbye, Rudy.
Goodbye. It's been a long time. I should have left you without a dope pizza system.
Of course not.
The Force is calling to you.
Look, there's no way that in some convoluted turn of events, I might appear again in the future.
I got big nuts, and if you're going to criticize anything, you got to criticize my nuts.
Hello, Scott.
Rudy. Rudy North.
Scott, I'm back.
Returned. He's back. That was dramatic.
That was huge.
Hello, Jason. Hello,
good
Scott.
To see you, Rudy.
First of all, you got to know I'm coming in, well, not as piping hot as usual.
Usually you're fresh out of the oven. You are.
I'm coming in a little less hot
to
than
the
usual,
touch.
Scott.
Yeah, you seem a little somber, a little. I mean, that was a contemplative.
It was contemplative
theme.
For sure. I definitely am coming in hot, but just not as hot.
Not
as
hot. I mean, I would not want to touch you with a bare hand.
Yeah, I'm still sweating a little bit.
Right.
How you doing, Scott?
I'm great, Rudy.
Jason, how are you?
You know, Rudy, I'm terrific.
I just want to say, I loved you on Legion.
Thank you so much. I
You're
appreciate that, Rudy.
It was incredible. Oh, okay. It was great.
All right.
Thank you
I
so much.
I gotta catch up with that.
Like a wolf
point.
Or something. Anyways, I'm glad to be back, Scott. And
yeah, I mean, as everyone who listened to that previously on could tell.
I had a quick question
oh, sure,
about
yeah.
previous
question.
One.
Yes.
Was there an episode recently where a TIE fighter was on the show?
Yeah. And someone talking about the Force?
Because I distinctly heard a TIE fighter pass by.
Yeah.
Well, of course, I do want to say I'm back from hell. I'm no longer the devil, Scott.
You're no longer the devil. Okay, yes. Rudy North has been on the show for a few years at
yes,
this point.
Yes, a few years, and of course I quickly became a fan favorite. But those
self-proclaimed.
Self-proclaimed, but of course self-fulfilling prophecy. I just want to chop it up with my friends, and I don't really want to talk about the long journey it took for me to get back here.
What are you chopping up?
Yeah.
Chopping up a salad, like a Cobb salad?
You know, I'm not a big salad guy.
Same.
That's canon.
That, of course, is canon. I'm big on the couscous and sort of ancient grains.
Oh, gotta love those quinoa.
I love a quinoa.
Ooh.
What's good for the couscous is good for the gander gander.
Did Shakespeare say that?
I think he might have.
I think
Look,
he might have.
What I want to know, though, okay, let's
course,
not talk
Scott.
About your very complicated backstory.
Yeah, because I think that's going to be a Stitcher because, premium show or something.
Yeah, this may be a
from what I heard.
Just unpacking the rudimentary North.
Yeah. From what I heard, the last 6 months, getting from hell to earth is a epic story that I think is about 6 episodes of a Stitcher.
A Homeric
premium.
Odyssey.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
They're calling it a podcast opera.
So you're angling for a Stitcher premium
no,
payday.
Scott,
is that what
I'm
this
not
is?
Angling for anything.
You know, this is smart, though, because if the fans demand it, like, the Earwolf will have to
it's
give
just,
it to you.
On these shows, we don't have time to talk about it.
We don't have
it,
time to get into these things.
But if we do want to get into it, no, no, we don't. Right.
Let's talk about what you want to talk about. What's going on?
Well, I'm looking for a new job, Scott.
You looking for a
new job?
Okay.
And it's a lot harder than it used to be, Scott.
Yeah. So your last job, of course, was being Satan in hell.
I was being Satan, and of course,
it's not really something that translates to an application.
No, because look, I have a lot of experience, but then they ask how you got the job, and I'm like, magical powers.
Is that part of the application?
It is.
How'd you get the job?
It's like job experience, date, beginning, date ending.
And how'd you get it?
How'd you get this job?
I would also assume that looking at your resume would be like a really eclectic group.
One of them being
Santa.
You worked at like a donut shop.
It'd be Lyft driver, Target employee, donut shop owner.
Yeah.
Santa Claus, the devil. Christmas tree salesman? They're going to ask me why I'm such a journeyman, Scott, and I don't have an answer for them.
Yeah, I understand. So what field of work are you looking to get into?
Well, Scott, the other day I was walking down the street, of course. And
it was the other day, of course.
It was the other day. Yeah. I was walking down the street, and I walked past KCRW.
Okay, that is a local to California, Los Angeles radio station.
A public radio station. And because it was public, I thought, they can't stop me from coming in here.
It's like a library.
Yep. It's like a library.
Guess what? Your taxpayer dollars
built
that whole thing.
Exactly.
As far as I'm concerned, and this, I think, is the truth for anybody in the world, in this country, rather, not the world, you can go into any public radio station and they have to put you on the air.
Yeah, they have to give you a drive time DJ.
Because that's what NPR is all about, drive time DJ.
I mean, we talk about the open door policy here, but I mean, anyone can.
Anyone can. So right now, I'm the sidekick for a morning zoo crew radio station.
We have a zoo crew.
On KCRW.
Yes,
Nick Harcourt and everyone?
They switched it up.
Jason Bentley?
They switched it up.
Jason Bentley and Rudy North.
Yeah. Yeah,
you
exactly. And then I come in, I'm like, "What's up, motherfuckers?" How you doing, Virginia?
How are you, Virginia?
I'm so good. Thanks again.
What were you saying was funny?
So it's funny that you say that you guys were in town doing theater because, well, I'm retired. I've been retired for.
You're a journalist.
Yes.
Is that right?
So
you're a retired journalist?
I'm an informal journalist.
Informal journalist. Mm-hmm. Oh, a citizen journalist, they sometimes say these days.
Exactly. So I go to different theater throughout the Evanston area, including
different theatrical events at various theaters.
Yeah, productions. Recently, I saw a fourth grade rendition of Oliver.
Oliver, based upon the Dickensian Oliver Twist saga.
Can I ask, Scott, were you ever in a production of Oliver?
I was not, although I've seen many a Bill Sykes tread upon the boards in my day, but have never actually essayed any of those roles. Yeah.
Yeah, I truly, this specific show that I saw, I had a lot of opinions about. So I typically write about the productions afterwards, and I send them into the local newspaper.
Are they published?
Sometimes they are, yeah.
Oh, okay.
The Evanston Journal, as an editorial.
As editorial, not as reviews.
Not
in the arts section.
No, as editorial.
Are you a lot of opinions contained within your?
Oh yeah.
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 But you
got a lot to say.
You are on the masthead. It's not a letter to the editor.
No, it's editorial.
Great.
It's editorial.
Yeah, great.
Okay. And so, you know, for example, in this case, I like to go to the talk back after the play, and then I take
which
my
sign of a good fourth play. Grade shows have.
Yeah, so yeah. I said this one. I said to him,
"When I saw Angels in America, I was like, where's the talk back?"
Yeah,
I know I've spent six hours here, but I want
bring
the talk back.
Tony Kushner out here. I got a lot to say.
Yeah.
So I said at this one. I said I got up. And I said, so you guys.
Were you alone, by the way? Did you know anyone in the play? Why did you go?
Not a soul. Not a soul.
Not a soul
and I
contained
stood up,
therein.
I stood up. I said, first of all, the theater's freezing. I don't understand how you expect us to watch this. I'm frozen to the bone.
Mm.
And secondly,
what was the temperature? Could you get a
69.
That's pretty good for a theater. That's a hilarious temperature.
It's
the funniest shit I ever heard.
I mean, that's like.
That sounds like some free.
Guys, I know you want a high five right now, but that's not that kind of show.
I'm going to reach over. All right, here we go.
I mean,
let's just get out of the way.
All right.
Okay. Woo! We got it. All right, good.
My lips were blue. My lips are frozen.
You blew with your lips
boy.
In the 69. Okay, I don't know what you're trying to get at here.
Let me ask, this was the first thing you said?
This was the first thing I said. I said.
Was it the first thing anyone said? Were you the first to rise to your feet?
Absolutely.
Can I ask a question? Were you the only person at the talk back?
There were some people cleaning up.
Okay.
Oh.
Were they talking back?
Was this a formal talk back? Or were you just talking back to the people who were cleaning up and kind of breaking the stage?
Some of the actors like came out to meet their family afterwards.
Exactly. They were around and everyone's talking about the show, giving each other compliments. I said, hold on a second, because I got a couple other things to say. I said, first of all, real basic approach to doing Oliver. Right? Mm-hmm. We could have done something fun, set it in the 70s.
Now, you said 70s. You said we could have. We could have done something fun. But you have no involvement in this production.
No. Okay. My son went to the rival school when he was coming up.
Oh, okay.
But
coming up where? Do you mean when he was growing up? Or?
When he was coming up. Oh, and okay. So I said, this has nothing to do with that, but this is absolutely... You know, you guys could have had something fun here. The orphan.
What would a 70s production of Oliver be like? With everyone with like afros and wearing
disco.
So I'm thinking, exactly. The orphans, let's put that in the 70s, right? Let's do disco with
just
that.
Just the orphans.
Platform shoes, tiny little boys in bell-bottom pants.
Sure.
That's not a stretch. That the audience would be on board for that.
Sure.
So your review is a full suggestion on what genre to change the play to.
Your review, forgive me, sounds a lot more like notes.
Yeah, it's kind of like you want to be the director.
Well, they published it, and guess what? Everyone was up in arms with me.
That's irresponsible of the newspapers.
There were lots of letters responding to mine.
You got to talk to so many people down at the newspaper.
Well, she wants them. She's not going to talk to them. She wants them to be published.
I know, but if you're getting in trouble, man. I just, wow, man.
Yeah, I don't know. And so, then,
can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Have you ever thought about coming out of retirement to maybe direct some of these plays?
Oh, God. Well, I'm a very busy woman at home.
Wait, what did you retire as? Yeah. Was that your job, directing plays?
I was the CEO of one of those companies that makes the pillows that has sayings on them.
Sayings on them.
Oh. One of those pillows that has sayings. You were the CEO of a company you'd rather not mention. You just say it's one.
And so, you know, pillows like live, love, die.
Live, love, die.
Wait, are those three
That's
different
a grim
pillows?
Message.
Ooh, those inspirational pillows.
Is that one pillow or three different pillows?
Live, love on the front, die on the back. So if you die in your sleep, they just turn the pillow around.
That's fucked
Smaller feet keep you closer to the stove. Things like that.
Oh, I don't know that I've ever heard that.
Are you writing these when you were working there? Were you writing these? Okay.
Yeah, and I was hiring the people who wrote them, mostly family members.
Oh, was this your company? Were you the CEO of your own company?
Yes. Well, it started as my father's company, but I'm a self-made woman and I inherited it.
Those two things.
Was it a pillow company when your father had it?
But it was more like the pillows that you guys were talking about, long pillows.
But you like shortened the pillows and added sayings to them?
Exactly.
So you went from a sleep pillow to a decorative pillow company. That was your innovation for your family's business.
Exactly.
How is the business now?
Yeah, when you say you're retired.
Is it thriving?
We're good online.
You are.
You're good online.
So it still exists online.
But brick and mortar no longer.
Yes.
Did you have brick and mortar pillow stores? Is
we
that
did.
A thing?
It, we did.
Oh, that seems like ill-advised.
What was it called? Pillows and More or something like that?
It was called Don't Forget That Pillow.
Don't forget that pillow. Well, that's forget good advice that pillow. To,
because
know,
most
a lot of times,
people forget the pillow.
Yeah, when you're shopping for something, it
and
can
you
be
can't
easy
forget
to forget
it
the pillow.
When it has a saying.
Right.
Yes.
You never forget the saying on a pillow like
right.
that.
Right. Did any say never forget and have like a picture of the Twin Towers
sure.
falling?
We did have one with the Twin Towers, but it didn't say anything.
Oh.
Okay.
Cool.
Smart. I like that. Was it one of those pillows that you could like run your hand up and down? It would change the image. And so in one image, the towers are standing and in the other, they have crumbled to the ground.
You know, they didn't make that technology till recently, but I would hire you.
Anything about controlled demolitions or?
Oh, what about Building 7? Is that in? Do you have any Building 7 pillows?
Oh, God,
can
I wish.
Fuel
9/11
melt
was an inside.
Steel beams.
I wish.
Anything
these are all
that's
fantastic
like
ideas.
Little feet keep you closer to the stove. 9/11 was an inside job.
No, nothing.
Nothing like that.
Nothing like that.
So, Darren, it's so nice to meet you. You're an historian.
An historian and an entrepreneur.
Oh, and wow. An entrepreneur. Oh, yeah. Great. Okay, we have a lot of entrepreneurs on the show, not as many historians.
And are the two related? Did your entrepreneurial spirit come out of your historian kind of career?
It did. It did. The passion that I wanted to pursue and my hobby grew into my entrepreneurship. I am the silent co-founder of the National Bobblehead Hall of Fame and Museum in Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Oh, wow.
The National Bobblehead Museum, is that what you said?
And Hall of Fame.
Yeah. And Hall of Fame. Yeah. Hall of Fame for bobbleheads?
Yeah, Hall of Fame. Well, that's fun because it gets sports people in it. And you know what? Bobbleheads.
Oh, so the inductees into the Hall of Fame are the Hall of Famers of the sports themselves. It's not like it's this bobblehead.
Are you inducting
is so
bobbleheads?
Good.
Yeah.
We're inducting bobbleheads, not people.
Okay. Right. This is why we ask.
But funny you should mention, bobbleheads are usually of people.
Sure.
And sometimes true. Animals. A fox.
But is the Hall of Fame, I'm so sorry to clarify
that's
this.
That's all right.
Is the bobblehead the Hall of
Did
Fame?
Did you say a fox?
A fox.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure. Got fox it. And a bear. All right. Yeah.
Is the bobblehead fox. Hall of Fame represent the Hall of Famer sports figures that have bobbleheads? So like, for example,
or are they just good bobbleheads?
Pete Rose is ineligible to be in the Baseball Hall of Fame,
but he could be such a good bobblehead.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking. Could his bobblehead be in the Bobblehead Hall of Fame?
Yeah, not to further confuse things, but it can.
Great.
What about that fox? Did he get into the Hall of Fame?
Yeah, the really good fox did.
The good one did. Yeah. How many foxes are in there?
Two.
Two.
Two. Okay, but the really good one was...
Yeah, there are two really good ones that are in there. Okay. But also, Pete Rose bobblehead is in there. Hank Aaron bobblehead is in there.
Okay. What makes
Ted Cruz bobblehead is in there.
Ted Cruz bobblehead.
What makes that bobblehead Hall of Fame worthy?
What makes a Hall
worthy?
Of Fame bobblehead?
Pretty much someone saying, hey, I'm mailing you my bobblehead. Will you put it in your Hall of Fame?
But then let me ask you this, because you also run the Bobblehead Museum.
Yeah.
So...
Are those ones you pick up yourself?
I don't want to further confuse things, but the Bobblehead Museum and Hall of Fame are one and the same.
Oh, okay. So every bobblehead
the same collection
that resides
in
within
the museum is, in fact, in the Hall of Fame.
Is there a Venn diagram where there are parts that are in the museum and Hall of Fame, but not... Do you know what I mean?
That's a great point. They are almost a concentric circle.
Oh, geez. Okay.
So now you mentioned three co-founders, and you said you're a silent co-founder.
Uh-huh.
Describe the corporate structure.
Because you're talking so much about it right now.
Right, yeah. Well, because I love it. It's my passion. It's my hobby. It's my job.
But you're not being silent
about
it.
When does the silent part start?
Meaning when you started the business, you were a mysterious figure who...
I was the money man.
Got it. Oh. So somebody else was the idea person.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So this was not your idea. You just provided the capital.
That's right.
So you saw the opportunity, but you didn't necessarily have the passion.
No, I had the passion.
Oh, great.
I had the money, and I had two friends that had a bigger bobblehead collection than I had.
Oh, how big was yours when you started?
Mine was about 1,000 bobbleheads.
1,000?
They had 1,200 bobbleheads and...
Between them?
1,500 bobbleheads respectively.
Oh, wow.
I see. 2,700 bobbleheads.
And then it's grown. We opened our museum and Hall of Fame earlier this year in February.
Oh, you did?
And we have almost 7,000 bobbleheads currently.
Wow. You've... And
I
people
can give
are...
you a specific figure.
You can't.
It's No, I can. It's
you can.
It's almost 7,000, but specifically it's 6,969.
Whoa! Whoa!
I love 69.
I love that.
So you
high fives all around.
So where did you get all these? Do people send them, you said, or you're buying them, or?
Well, I usually would get 3 weeks of vacation per year, and I would just drive around the country buying up bobbleheads with my disposable income.
And what did you do for
a historian?
Well, because of this, I'm a historian, but I was an actuary in real life.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I see. An actuary. You were in the insurance game, and you have a lot of disposable income from that. Were you on a bonus structure where the more policies you signed, you got more money? Or I'm trying to see, like, were you purely on salary?
Can you break down?
How do you have so much money?
I can answer that.
Do you have any tax? Do you have any tax forms? I'd love
any
to know.
Any liens on any of your properties? Anything like that?
Nope, no. Nothing like that.
How is your finances structured? Was it a bonus at the end of the year? Are you salaried? Is it an hourly or weekly
wage?
Was
it an expected bonus where everyone was like, oh no, we didn't get our bonuses. I don't know how I'm going to.
Not to further confuse things, but everything you guys mentioned.
Oh, okay, great.
That's what it was.
And an actuary, like in being an actuary, are you like, like in the business of
risk assessment.
Risk assessment for, you know, people's mortality, or for, was it specific to industry?
Or for museums that, you know, might be set on fire, or bobbleheads that break?
Anything that has any risk associated and money associated with, an actuary comes in, crunches the numbers, and then it's party time.
Can I ask you about the numbers?
After the numbers are crunched.
And then you party.
And then you party.
Can I ask you, what's the most expensive bobblehead?
Are there any rare, valuable ones here?
In our museum, yes, there are some. They're extremely.
Or any museum. I'll take any museum.
Most museums have expensive stuff in them, Scott.
Sure. But I guess bobblehead museums. Ours Let's limit it to those.
Really, technically, there's only one, which is the museum and Hall of Fame. Mm. And yeah, we have some very expensive bobbleheads.
What's your favorite bobblehead?
My favorite bobblehead?
Yeah.
Probably Robin Yount of the Milwaukee Brewers.
Oh, okay.
Born and raised in Milwaukee. Harvey's Wallbangers, Brew Crew for life.
Wow. Wow. Okay, so you were born and raised in Milwaukee.
Yep.
And that's wonderful.
Was this given out at one of the games? Like at a game? Wow. Where do they give this out?
That was unfortunate.
I tried to pick up the slack. I mean, Scott had a meltdown.
Rudy jumped in there, but Scott like froze.
I got stage fright all of a sudden.
It's like I've been gone for 6 months and I don't even know who Scott is anymore.
Scott, like, you look like, where am I?
I suddenly
you
became
just like woke up
aware of my surroundings. You're like, what was happening?
Where am I? How long has this been going on? All right, let me
catalog. What am I doing?
I'm guessing that's rudimentary.
11 years of this? But that is wonderful.
It is wonderful.
Thanks, yeah.
How much is admission to the bobblehead?
Right now, it's $6 for admission.
But you're planning to change, have changed recently?
Yeah, we have changed recently. It used to be $4. Now it's up to $6. Mm. But we've added a lot of things. Like you can drink. There's a full bar inside the.
Oh, okay. Oh, neat. Open bar, or do you charge per cocktail?
That's a great question.
Is that a good one?
Now, I know I'm wearing a shirt that says, "Ask me anything." I'm a dumbass, but. It's not an open bar, Scott.
I'm just saying.
That's unfortunate.
A great deal. $6 to get in and then free drinks.
More businesses should do that.